Hi, I'm Padmesh Kankipati. I work for different organizations as an employee for recently JP Morgan Chase and Aflac, and working now for Florida Blue, Blue Cross Blue Shield. So today I wanted to, the theme is going to be the, we talk about modern data architecture. How do you apply that to your, to the benefit of your organization? What is the approach, right? I'm going to talk about some key points. So just to start with an introduction on this, so enterprise architecture is defined as a comprehensive operational framework, right, that explores all of an organizational functional areas while defining how technology benefits and serve the organization overall mission. So basically, it's a framework of the enterprise architecture. And the framework has been developed, and there are a lot of methodologies that have come across. And a few of them I just mentioned here are famous, but more of them, but just mentioned a few of them. So one is TOGAF. The TOGAF framework, it provides the principles for planning, coordinating, and designing and implementation and governance of the enterprise architecture. It helps the organizations, the businesses to implement a standard approach to the enterprise architecture. Jackman framework is again a framework defined, it's one of the founders of the enterprise architectures, it's named after. And it has some six core principal architectural focal points and defined by taxonomy. And FEA framework is developed, it is mainly started for mandating the IT implementation in the federal agencies. And it is extensively used by the government, but it is open to anybody to use. And Gartner came up with an approach, a methodology for enterprise architecture. What their, it's for their consulting practice, general services. It is a very practical approach, and it focuses on how do the business outcomes. The, out of these, TOGAF, it's said that the most of the organizations adopt TOGAF framework, and around 80% of the large enterprises have some form of TOGAF implementation. And the TOGAF framework looks at the architectural foundations as business technology, application, and data architecture. So business is a blueprint for how the businesses understand the challenges, how the organization is understood, how to align the goals and the demands, and the technology, and the, let's go to application. Application architecture talks about how we build the applications, how the applications behave, how they interact with each other, and how they interact with the users. And technology architecture is a stack of framework. It is about the hardware and software infrastructure that supports the applications. And data architecture talks about everything the data has to deal with. How do we consume the data? How do we store the data? How do we utilize it? And how do we process the data? So all that comes into the data architectures. So now to enable an enterprise enablement, we talk about enterprise enablement. If these stack together with the data architecture being foundation, and the governance being at the top as a governing framework that provides a monitoring framework. So as you see, the data architecture is important. It is the foundation. And how do we enable this to an organization to get into a modern data? So we talk about legacy systems, legacy platforms, and we want to modernize. And what is our, how do we do that? How do we approach that? And so if you look at the process of enablement at a very high level, the first important aspect is that your data strategy has to align with the business. So what are your the business goals? So, see, one of the concerns of a lot of organizations, CFOs and others, you know, executives is, How do we leverage the IT with the business to provide value? So the IT enablement comes from the business alignment. And when you do the business alignment, then you go with the process where you do a current state assessment and come up with the modernization goals, what you want to accomplish with your modernization, right? And proposed future state and implementation roadmap. So you go through these steps when you're trying to move into a modern technology, whether it is for bringing new features, growth of the customers, to customer retention, using technology to kind of plan for your future and cost savings. So you got to come up with a plan, starting with business alignment and going with these at a very high level I'm talking about. So if we talk about business alignment of data strategy, we have business goals alignment with data strategy. And then I just give an example here that if you have business goals as a customer digital experience, right? And you want business insights and operational efficiencies, reduce risk and fraud, your data strategy has to align with that in terms of service-based architecture, fast access data cache, data lake, analytical data mocks, enterprise business glossary, and customer 360. So you are trying to come up at a high level, what is my business goal, and how do I align with for my data strategy? So and the current state assessment as a next step, you look at your technology stack and various domains and see where you are and in data warehousing, business intelligence, in governance, in data quality, information architecture, data integration, in analytics and metadata management, master data management. So where you are today and where you want to go. And when you look at the technology, there are very exciting, a lot of exciting technologies available. Big data on Hadoop, NoSQL databases, cloud, microservices, real-time streaming, enterprise service bus, in-memory, GPU databases, we hear a lot. So how do we bring them into our organization, right? So here is just again at a very high level, how do we take an example of having a business goal? So my business goal is I want to enable customer digital experience, right? So the use case for that is you come up with a use case, which is online quoting. I want to develop an online quoting system for my business. And then your digital experience requirements comes out to be that it has to be seamlessly mobile. It is always available. It has low latency response, support concurrent users, and at scale and built for change, right? So with these, you come up with a data strategy of a fast access, developing a fast access data cache to enable the business goals of customer digital experience. So, and as per you take a NoSQL database as a technology recommendation. So we take out of those, so we have established here that the data architecture as a foundation provides us a means to enhance our technology roadmap. And one of these is a data lake, and I'm going to just to focus on one of that aspects of data lake. Some of the key points on how do we enable this. So if we look at a data lake, first of all, a data warehouse is a Bill Inman's definition of data warehouse is a subject-oriented, integrated, time-variant, and non-volatile. So it is a domain-specific integrated data. You take the different domains and integrate the data, and you hold the history of the data. And once it gets into the data warehouse, it's not going to change, right? So that is how the data warehousing concept has been there for decades. And Ralph Kimball has a simple definition, which again, the same thing, but it means it's a copy of transactional data specifically structured for query and analysis. So it is structured data with well-defined structures and the data layout that you can easily create query and do the analysis, right? So, and James Dixon from Pentagon, I'm quoting him, he provided a definition of a data lake. So if a data warehouse is a store of bottled water, cleared, packaged, and structured, the data lake is a large body of water in natural state streaming from multiple sources for the user to dive in. So the data lake, from the concept of data warehouse, is very open, as you can see. And so in addition to that, comparison of a lake versus a bottled water, if you look at the data lake, there are a few aspects. How do we compare it with the data warehouses? One is the data storage, is that data lake can hold any kind of data, right? So if you are looking at a data warehouse, there are a lot of analysis goes on what kind of data needs to go into data warehouse, what needs to be excluded. For the data lake, you have everything going in raw data. And the data lakes are built on commodity hardware that is cost effective and cheap. And the data stores or can expand horizontally. So we had decades before SMP architecture is very famous. Then Teradata introduced MPP, and then Netezza and IBM adopted that. And nowadays, in the same model but with a different design, we have Hadoop as a big data architecture. So, and the data storage and data types. So with the, as you see before, the data warehouse only hosts structured data. So with the data lake, you can have both structured and unstructured data, and schema-less, which means that schema on read or schema on write versus. When we build the data warehouse, you need to know how do we store the data. With the data lake, the schema is open. Like, you know, you schema on read, you load the data and then provide the schema later. So, and the user types, with the data warehouse, you have users mainly as operational users and business users, and some analysts doing some analysis, analytic work. But with the data lake, in addition to those, you support data scientists for doing deep analytics. So if you're in the data warehouse, if you're doing a descriptive analytics, which is like why it happened, I'm sorry, it's what happened, right? So what happened with this? If we go with the data lake, it is more of a predictive analytics. It's like what can happen, and have diagnostic analytics of why it happened, and then prescriptive analytics of recommendations, right? So you can have much deeper analytics with the data lake, with the raw data. And agility, when you store the raw data, you can quickly build different paths of data processing and data analytics needs, for data analytics needs. Whereas in data warehouse, you have to go through the life cycle model for either it's data life cycle, data modeling life cycle, for many, any small, even for a small change, and it takes time to make the change. The agility is some advantage. So so data lake can be used for many purposes, and some of the uses I mentioned here is data staging, and as a raw data repository. And if you use it just for raw data repository, data staging, data lakes don't have much value, because you are just having it as a in front of the data warehouse just to feed the data. But the data warehouse, data lakes can do data transformation, data discovery, and data analytics, and as mentioned, they do deep data science. So now I'm going to skip this. As you're going through, you may think that I'm going to talk about what is Hadoop and data lake. So what we're going to do is look at some of these key points when your organization is embarked on the journey. So the first one I'm looking at is, what is the best Hadoop cluster configuration for my computation needs? So you decided to build a data lake, and you wanted to build it on Hadoop. And let's look at how you start. So the recommendation is always to start small. And as you build the use cases and workload, then you got to balance the some of the resources that is competing. So the applications that run, that the use cases that run on the data lake, they are either compute bound or I/O bound, right? The CPU and RAM versus disk and network. So if you are taking ingestion, for example, it's high on I/O, but slow on computer resources. And if machine learning, high on computer resources, low on I/O. So if you don't, so as you grow, you have to balance this by using the monitoring tools to make sure that your compute and I/O is balanced. So otherwise, you will say that my Hadoop system is very slow. When I run some process, I run some query, it's running very, very slow. So keep that. And so as you increase the mixture of use cases and workload profiles, keep the compute and I/O capabilities balanced. So if, for example, if the cluster compute is constrained, you're having a high processing on the computer capacity, the compute capacity, adding graph processing application will cause a processing slowdown, right? So while an ETL application may not, right? So if you go on to further on how do we kind of bring this balance, let's look at these node types, right? So Hadoop has four node types, like master, worker, and utility and edge nodes. So master nodes controls various Hadoop services. Worker nodes does the heavy lifting for the processing. Utility node controls other Hadoop services, and we have edge nodes that is mainly used for data landing zone and a contact point from outside world. So the edge node is one where the interactions of the Hadoop system with the outside world happens. So if you look at the services that reside on these type of nodes, the master node services has name node. So if the data node stores the data, the name node stores the metadata. It stores the metadata and it has the file system tree. And the journal node is synchronizes the name node with a standby name node. So in case of a failover, the standby nodes gets the edits from the journal nodes. And then failover controller for our automatic failover of the name node. If the available name node, active name node is not available. Yarn resource manager, as it says, it manages the resources for the yarn. And it does several things, and one of the things being to taking care of the scheduler. So if you look at yarn, how the yarn is architected, so on the name node, on the cluster at for a system level, you have the resource manager. At the node, you have node manager and the application master at the application level. And the yarn history server, it's when resource manager finishes a job, it purges from the memory. So the job information. So the history of job logs are stored or taken care or tracked by the yarn history server. And Spark history server, there's a similar thing on the application history for the event logs. And HBase master, it takes control of the various, HBase servers. And Sentry and Zookeeper are the controlling points for the services offered from those Sentry and Zookeeper. So, and these are mostly, as you can see, the master node is a controlling node. So, all the services that do for various operations of controlling their own tools and resources have the master node as a base. And worker node services have the similarly, they are work intensive, while the master node is as a controller, and worker node where the processing happens is as data node and the yarn node manager and HBase regional server. So HBase has split the tables into regions, and the regions are controlled by the region server. And Solr and Kafka brokers reside on the worker node services. And utility service, utility node services host other type of services like Apache Ambari, service databases, Kerberos admin server, Hive Metastore server, Ouzi server, and Flume agent. So edge node services have Hadoop clients, web UI, the UI interface that web Hue provides, and the Hive server SQL interface, and Flume agent. These are some of the services that are running on the edge node. Yarn resource manager also has a UI. So basically, if you understand what kind of services run, what are the demands for these services, you can start and configure the way you want, but basically, just for the ease, we have three configurations defined. One is a small configuration where you have three master nodes and less than three worker nodes. We have implemented all this on a single rack, and you co-located the utility and edge services. So in this case, both the master nodes and the utility nodes, all of them and the worker nodes, they are on the single server. This is for a small workload, and that's how you start. And then you go to the medium configurations, you have three master nodes, and you have, but the number of worker nodes is now more, and you have two racks. You have distributed your workload onto two racks, and you have a dedicated utility and edge nodes. So if you look at it, as you see in two racks, now the Hadoop is rack aware. So when you distribute on the multiple racks, it takes care of the fail-safe conditions. So you have here, worker nodes on both the racks. And in the large configurations, when you have heavy workloads, you are looking at a five master nodes and more than 200 worker nodes on more than two racks, and a dedicated utility and edge nodes greater than two. So you see, you have these multiple racks. The data is distributed through the worker nodes, and the control is distributed through the master nodes across the racks. And you the maximum if you exceed 5 or 6 master nodes, that is the limit, right? If you exceed that, it will be taxing to the system because you are doing too much of resource management, and it's not good. It is going to bring down your performance. So limit that, and the mostly, even though you can say large nodes greater than 200, the practical limitation is usually you don't see any of the installations more than 500 nodes on distributed on multiple racks. But there are examples. The Yahoo has a cluster operating with 4,500 nodes. So that is a very rare situation. And let's look at the other aspect when you are going onto the Hadoop data lake is a dedicated RDBMS instance for Hadoop cluster, right? So we are talking about Hadoop as a distributed platform, and it has a distributed file system, resource management, scheduling framework, and we are talking about Spark as a computational framework, and Hive as analytical SQL engine, HBase as a storage engine, and the question is, why do we need RDBMS? So there are many services that are running on the Hadoop system for their task scheduling. They have data related to how the metadata, they generate the metadata, and they have plans and schedules, and they wanted to store that with fault tolerance, right? So when we're talking about transactional features for the metadata with ACID compliance, then obviously we require this RDBMS. So for example, the Hive metastore, the schema definitions are stored, but while the schema definitions are being changed, you can also query that, right? So that kind of a read-write consistency, if you want. You wanted to set up an RDBMS for storing that metadata, the state, and all that information related to some of the services. So what these services, just for an example, Hive Metastore, the Apache UZI, Hue, the Apache Ranger, and Apache Embody, these are some of the services that generate this data that needs a RDBMS. So like I mentioned here, the Hive Metastore to store and maintain all the SQL schemas defined by users and applications using HiveQL. So when you're running queries, schema updates require ACID compliance, and user permissions, logs, table partitioning, and table statistics, all this information. And similarly, UZI needs to store job history, current state of workflow, and the workflow and the coordinator and bundle details it has to store. And Ranger Sentry, they store users, group permissions, and rules. Audit logs, those are the big, become quite big. And cluster management tools like Ambari store user accounts, job execution details, system alerts, node metrics, usage, health check, and other reports. So there's quite a bit of requirement for a relational database. So the recommendation, the first consideration you should look into is having a centralized database for all of your service needs. What this helps is that it helps your maintenance and makes it easy for the administration, and also for these RDBMS, configure this for high availability with the data replication, perform load balancing for quick failover, and let the IT management services, which does the database infrastructure, handle this instead of your database Hadoop administration, because IT manages many of the databases across the organization. So the service database should also, it helps to go with them and maintain for high availability, replication, and such. So next we're going to talk about what are the design principles for user cluster interactions. So if you look at this, the user access for Hadoop happens through programming access, it's like API, REST, JDBC, ODBC, command line access, and web UI. And so we look at the access patterns of, there are primarily two access patterns, how the data is accessed. One is going through the master role and getting the metadata and communicating back to the worker roles. HBase does it this way. And they look at the second access pattern, where you go to the service endpoint and a service endpoint communicates to the master and service nodes. This is what Hive does it. So the user access, so one thing recommendation to start with is limit your user interaction with the master and worker nodes and limit that, and access services endpoints running on the edge nodes. And edge nodes with no cluster services, virtual machine for user logging, so that you don't have, you have an edge node for just for user logins and issue commands. There's no other services running on it, so that you can avoid the risk of unintentional something that being done by the users, that if the important services are hosted on the edge node. So so Hadoop framework for built for high availability, as we know. So what else we need is, so one thing we need to make sure that each and every layer in the Hadoop cluster is highly available. Hadoop framework provides high resilience, but the whole platform from top to bottom and all these services needs to be planned for high availability to prevent any kind of single point of failure. Just so at a just high level, architected individual services for each individual services, look at what are the failure points, monitor the health, in case of failure, conduct root cause analysis, and create a detailed playbook. So if just for an example for Kafka, the way you design this is to you deploy brokers across multiple server racks using broker rack ID. So the Kafka broker has a rack ID awareness, which lets you to replicate the partitions across the multiple racks. So use that feature and deploy minimum three brokers so that you have at least three partitions replicated for a failover. And consider RAID 10. Striping and disk failures. So even though there is a recovery and there is a few seconds of latency when the disk recovery happens, but when you have a RAID, you can prevent that and minimize it. And also the Kafka relies on Zookeeper, and it also relies on Sentry for authorization. So ensure that those services are running for your Kafka breaker not to come down with services. And so high availability, so increase resilience with RAID 1. Like I told that, you know, we can, the failover is built in, but when you have RAID 1, you minimize it. Why go down and wait, you know, few seconds for its recovery? Balance roles between master nodes. When the automatic failover happens, the services switch from one node to another one on the master node. So you got to rebalance to make sure that these services are distributed on the master nodes. Watch for any automatic failovers and do some manual adjustment for balancing or as required by the, as applicable by the tools. So master machines, have them on separate racks. So don't keep masters, make sure at least you have, as you go from small to big, masters are distributed across the racks, and have redundant UART switches, power distribution units, and spine network switches. And same services, like if you have two HBase master on the same machine, that's not good. So distribute that. And you should not never co-locate master and worker, because the even though master doesn't need a lot of resources like I/O or CPU, it requires a guaranteed requirement. So if you have a heavy job running and if some of the you know CPU is not available, some of the resources are not available, the master can go down. So even though it has a less requirement, don't club master with worker, because you don't know how the workloads come in. So one thing I want to add quickly is about, should you consider public cloud for Hadoop, right? So the public cloud, you have several benefits: cost savings, modernization, scalability, increased flexibility and agility, simplified operation complexity, and global reach. These are all some benefits that you get, you hear about. And the three public clouds, you know about Amazon, AWS, Microsoft Azure, and Google Cloud. So when it comes to compute and memory, all of them offer almost same features, right? All of them have general instances, which has a balance of compute and memory. And there are compute instances, which has a course specifies over memory for computer-heavy work. And memory instances emphasize on RAM. And storage instances on the local block devices for better performance, and accelerated instances that use GPU accelerators support use cases like, you know, machine learning with deep learning and such. So instance considerations, you need to look at the size of the instance, because you can scale up versus scale out, And you have to balance that. Ratio of compute to memory determined by specific use case, right? So you have different type of instances, which one you use depends on your use case. And so if you have 3 GB per CPU core, that's good for classification and clustering algorithms. But if you have 5 GB per CPU core, you need that for batch ETL workflows in Kafka. And if you're looking at material aggregates or partition joined operations, you need a 8 ratio of a GB to CPU cores, right? And for very large distributed joints and machine learning, you need 12. So that is a kind of a ratio. And instant options, we have several, but that is what provided here by the various cloud providers. So because we're running out of time, I wanted to quit some of these, kind of quickly go through. And what storage options, there are different storage options that is each of them provided. And one of the considerations for storage is, so for a remote block storage is good start for Hadoop in public cloud. And choose right lifecycle model, which is like suspendable clusters, one-off clusters, sticky clusters. Most of the implementation are suspendable clusters that you can detach the storage, but the data is not gone. When you want to use it, it can be reattached. Unlike the sticky clusters, once it's meant to be perpetual, once you take it off, the data is gone. Source of truth on object storage. It has a lot of remote Hadoop capabilities to log in and APIs. So use it for source of truth for remote block storage. The Hadoop systems, they offer a infrastructure with managed services, all of them. Amazon Elastic MapReduce, Microsoft Azure Insights, Google Cloud Data Pro. These are custom-built Hadoop platforms with services on it. So cloud and security, we just gave some, make sure that there can be a lot of unauthorized access, deployment risk, and application design risk. These are the major risks. And how the security settings on data storage, ensured everything is good, but application design, the API and access layers and authorization authentication controls, if there is a problem, your data has a hole, right? So the cloud and security is important that you encryption of data consider at rest and in flight. You document all the procedures of training for deployment. Have a review of sign-off for service configuration and testing protocols. Have a policy of rotating API access tokens for cloud services to ensure the security. So how do I design my data ingestion strategy? I wanted to quickly go through this in 1 minute. So the considerations for a data ingestion is what kind of source system, what kind of data structures, what are the storage formats, data accessibility timelines, patterns, incremental, you are doing incremental updates, multiple target system transformation needs. So for the understand the disk IO limitations on the source system, so if you have multiple threads, if you have the source system as this source system is the limitation for the ingestion. If they have multiple disks, use them. And so Hadoop can access any file format, but all file formats are not optimal. So CSV file is good for Spark maybe, but not for Hive. Similarly, if you have a compressed files, it's maybe good for network, but when they are not splittable, so GZIP is not splittable, so you may have to do pre-processing when you're bringing a compressed file. So, and database integration, you have to consider when you have an architecture where the Scoop is not good, Scoop is good for connecting directly to data nodes, but you have any limitations for the architecture where you got to go through the edge node, then you have to do a database export imports. So log files or streaming data, because the data is continuously written, you have to use streaming method like Flume or Kafka. So start with a batch before moving to complex ingestion methods. You have different micro batch, pseudo real-time batch, and all those, right? Time classification. Streaming data, Flume can be deployed without writing code. Kafka is good for fault tolerance. So there is a choice between Kafka or Flume. We got to know that they are complementary for each other. Clickstream analysis, I just wanted to have a example here, but I, because of time constraint, I cannot go through.
A lot of great information here.
And
a lot of great details.
Thank you.
If you guys have more questions, details, you're going to be here today over lunch.
Yeah.
Please find them and drill in. I know I had a lot of details I was interested in as well.
So. Right.
But thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Welcome.